information theory is both a scientific discipline, but it's also a way of thinking about, information. Everything around us is information, right? And we need to store information, we need to transmit information, we need to treat information, we need to get certain bits out of a lot of data that we have. And information theory is about finding fundamental limits of what can and what cannot be done, given that we have a certain amount of information. So it presents a measure of information and then tells us for various scenarios whether we can do certain things or not.
This is Rüdiger Urbanke, a full professor of the IC School at EPFL.
The basic, objects of information theory originally, as they were defined by Shannon, had to do with transmitting and storing information. And given a certain storage medium or given a certain source, it would tell us how much it was possible to compress information or compress a certain picture into the minimum amount of information there was, such that we could still retrieve the picture then, let's say, and restore it in something that was viewable.
This minimal number of bits to encode an information is called entropy. But what is the real nature of entropy?
So let's assume you have four possible events that can happen. And to keep it simple, let's assume they're all equally likely, okay? Now the entropy, so this probability distribution is a quarter probability that this happens, this happens, this happens, and this happens. And when you compute the entropy, and if it's what's called a uniform distribution, it turns out it's just a log two of the number of this size of, the outcome space. So this would be in this case two.
The logarithm in base two of a number x is the exponent n such that 2 to the power n is equal to x. In our case, we have x equals 4 since the number of possible numbers is equal to 4. And thus, the entropy is log in base 2 of 4, which is equal to 2, since 2 to the power 2 is equal to 4. Thus, the entropy of a random number uniformly distributed between 1 and 4 is equal to 2 bits.
So now, what is the interpretation of the 2, or what does this 2 mean? It tells us that if you, for example, now were thinking of a number from 1 to 4, and each of these numbers are equally likely, and I had to guess what this number it is, it means that I should be able to ask you just two binary questions, and if you truthfully answer those, then in average I should be able to figure out which of this number you thought about. Okay, so this entropy is the number of binary questions that I'm allowed to ask, and after I've asked this question, in average, I should be able to tell you what this object is.
So what are the two questions we need to ask here?
So let's try. We have the 4, right? Well, I could just ask you, was it 1? Okay, and you might say yes, no. Was it 2? Yes, no. Was it 3? Yes, no. Was it 4? Yes, no. But that turns out to be not a good strategy in general. Okay, so in this case, this would take more than two questions in average.
Let's compute it. If the answer is 1, you need 1 question. If the answer is 2, you need 2 questions. If the answer is 3, you need 3 questions. And if the answer is 4, well, actually, you only need 3 questions because you know that after the third question, the answer will necessarily be 4. In average, you'll thus need 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 3 all divided by 4, which is equal to 9/4, which is 2.25 questions. Now, this is more than the 2 questions that information theory promised.
So the right way to do it, if you think of entropy, is trying to take this whole set that you have and kind of ask the question that always, like, half the chances that the answer will yes and half the chance will be answer no. So, for example, in our case, I could ask, is the number smaller or equal than 2, right? So it's either 1, 2, or is it, larger or equal than 2? So it would be, strictly larger than 2, right? So 3, 4. And so if you would truthfully answer, let's assume you've thought about 2, I ask you this question. Well, after the first question, I would know that it's either 1 or 2. Now, given that I know it's 1 or 2, I would ask you, is it 1? Again, this would split the space into two parts. And so this is something which is a game called 20 questions. So you think of something I'm trying to guess, right? And so what's the minimum number of questions that I have to ask such that in average I will know what this object is? That's exactly the entropy.
Hopefully you now have an intuitive understanding of entropy, which measures the expected number of binary questions you'll need to retrieve a piece of information. But how does one compute entropy?
For something what's called a uniform distribution, so they're all equally likely, it's just the log of the number of objects you have. So that's fairly easy. And why is it the log 2? Because every time I can take this whole set and split it into two parts, right? So after the first question, you tell me yes or no, I have eliminated half of all the possible outcomes. And so, you know, that's why you get the logarithm in there.
But how does one compute entropy for non-uniform distributions?
If it's not uniform, right, then what would happen? So let's assume you have now 8 possible outcomes, but some are much more likely than the other ones. The principle that I talked about, that every question should separate out as much as possible, you know, which one it is, still applies. But now you're not going to take 2 sets of equal cardinality, so of equal size, so one set of 4 and another set of 4, but you're going to try to group these elements such that their probability is roughly the same. So if one maybe has probability a half, the rest, right, so you have 7 that should sum up over to the half, right, then you're going to ask simply the question, was it this guy that had half, or was it any of the other 7 that you had? Okay, so that would be the right question to ask. And so every question you're going to ask, you're trying to split the probabilities as close as possible. And if you do that, then it turns out that the number of questions you need in average is exactly the entropy. And I've never said exactly what this entropy is. So what is it? So if you have a source with probabilities pi, so numbers, non-negative numbers pi, that sum up to 1, then the entropy of this source is the sum of minus pi log base 2, if you want it in bits, pi. And so that gives you a number. And that equals the number of questions that you need to ask in order to sort out, in average, which of the elements it actually was.
And importantly, you know for sure that you cannot achieve better data compression than that.
Knowing what the fundamental limits are is very important, even though there might not be an actual engineering way to achieve it at the point when you have it. So it's simply having this fundamental limit there, telling you you can do it or not, is super useful, right? Let's assume you were a physicist. You know, you probably wouldn't spend a lot of time working on a perpetuum mobile because you know there's a physical law there that prevents it from ever happening, right? And so for us, this physical law are exactly some of the fundamental inequalities of information theory that tell us whether or not something is possible or not. And if it's not possible, then, you know, if someone will sell you now a patent and say, look, I can, over a wireless channel, I can transmit that amount of information and, you know, we'll all be happy, and you know that that just doesn't work given the physical or the information theory laws we have, well, you'll be suspicious and you're probably not going to buy the patent, right? But on the other hand, if you know that it's in principle possible, but perhaps we can't do it currently because our technology is not there, then you know that there should be a scheme to do it. And so then it's worth to invest, you know, time and effort in trying to reach these limits. So information theory sets these limits and so gives us basically the playground in which to do their research. And so that's a very, very important thing to have.
Now, all we've discussed here is actually only about exact compression. However, so-called lossy compressions are much harder to analyze formally, and determining optimal lossy compressions is basically still an open question.
If you take a basic source that's just zeros and ones and you want to reconstruct it exactly, then it's just the entropy that I talked about and it's all fine. But there is another kind of compression that is probably at least as important, and that's what's called lossy compression. So what is lossy compression? Take a photo, right? So you take a photo. So what is a photo? In most cameras, digital cameras, you have maybe a 1,000 times 1,000 pixels. So these are small little dots in your what's called a CD camera. The light impinges on it, and every pixel records, let's say in the simplest case, you know, if it's light or not, or maybe 8 values of intensity and probably also colors. So you get a certain amount of raw bits. That's the raw format that you have. But you can compress that picture to something smaller. Okay. Now, when we're talking about that you can compress, there's kind of a trade-off of whether or not you want to get the picture exactly back, or you just want to get a picture back that looks for you identical, so basically you see almost no distortion in there, but actually it has a little bit less information there. Okay, so there's a trade-off between how much distortion you allow and how many bits you have. And Shannon also characterized what's called this rate distortion trade-off. So the more distortion you allow, the fewer bits you need. Okay, and so there's a natural trade-off in here. Now, but then it becomes more complicated. Why? Because how much distortion we see is a very complicated, effect that's not easily described by a formula, right? So we as humans perceive 2 pictures the same, equal quality, worse or not. But to describe that in a simple mathematical formula is not easy. So there are all kinds of surrogate measures, signal to noise ratio, and many, many other measures. But they're all just, you know, kind of approximation of the true thing. And if you don't have a very simple mathematical description of, for this distortion trade-off, then it's hard to design schemes just, you know, purely based on that. So then there's a lot of trials and errors, you know, a lot of tests and experiments that you have to do. And that goes then way beyond just the standard Shannon setup. And that's why source coding in general is there's still more art than pure science in there, because it involves a lot of also, you know, psychological experiments that, you know, asking people for feedback, checking what is important, what is not important.
Anytime you move away from equally likely outcomes or introduce predictability, the entropy must go down.
Most channels are not of the form where I'm sending, let's say, a bit in, a zero and one in, and I will simply get exactly that bit out.